Okay. Hello. Do you hear me? Ah, now it's coming. Okay. Yeah, thank you for the invitation to be here in Sweden. So it's my second really short time. And a difficulty is about this invitation to speak in 20 minutes about like 100 exhibitions, what we did, or maybe less, I don't know. So, but the idea was that there was a couple of questions I should speak about festivals, and then festivals is a special theme for art production, but I don't want to show, it's a kind of strange thing when you speak about sound art, not to play any sounds. I have still the input in when I have time, I don't know if I have time to play all those some sounds, but the art form themselves allowed me not to show you pieces, because I think what is an important difference to other art forms is the presence of the visitor and the presence of the artwork. That means you have to be in the space. That is my or the single typical approach to sound art. So when I follow Andreas' kind of phenomenological categorization, then I find myself only in the last field with sound art Bernhard Leitner. So in the last years, I tried to rename this field, and I'm always speaking about sound installation art. It makes it a little bit easier to have the difference, which is also really nice described in the article from Andreas and Osa in this organized sound issue. And I have a book with me, one of the productions. Maybe I give it surround and then it can stay at the agency, I don't know. And it's even difficult to bring this kind of art form in a catalog form. So it's a book with all the exhibitions from the first 11 years of the gallery. And it's have also included in DVD with 7.5 hours of sound examples and text and photos. So my focus, as I said, to sound art, it's more like what Bernhard Leitner once labeled sound space art without any pronunciation. That means site-specific or even situation-specific art, where artists working with sound in spaces and in situations. And when we start in 96, that is maybe somebody of you remember this time, it's like 20 years ago around. And in this time, there will be not so much places where you can present sound installations worldwide. So there was a big exhibition in 96 in Berlin called Sonnambiente. And during this exhibition, I think being the main part of artists worldwide working with sound being presented in Berlin on several places. And in 95, I working in a freelance and without any income in a little non-profit organization in a special space, a church in Berlin. It's a old Baroque church, which was closed over 30 years in East Germany. You know, like in socialist time, also churches becoming sports places or swimming pools sometimes. In this case, it was a kind of storage space for furnitures. And when the wall coming down, as you heard maybe in Berlin, there have been a lot of spaces empty, and industrial spaces or others. And this was also this kind of founding years of Berlin. It's already a kind of history. And I think Berlin has still this kind of touch, or that's a town where you can do everything. And it's still possible. But when I studied in this time in the 90s at the Technical University, and as Björn said, I studied 2 years trombone from 86 to 88. And then I studied with Helga de la Mort-Haber, and my only degree that I have is a kind of pre-diploma at the Technical University, and it was my examiner was about sound installation, funny-wise, which is not in the academic world in the 90s what completely strange, because Helga de la Mort-Haber was the only one in the whole country or in Germany who did a research and also teach it. And a lot of her students are still in this kind of praxis in Germany mainly. So when we found in 96 the gallery, the idea was exactly the opposite of doing a festival, even when it's sometimes called a kind of festival. But to get in this time a real experience about installations, sound installations, you have to travel around the world, which I did, because there were not so much places in the art world, even few. Some music festivals did this kind of sound installations, but mainly as a kind of intermission thing between two concerts. You can run to a nice exhibition. And I was always not really impressed about the situation, so call it really positive. And the idea was to found or to start with a place or a space where artists can produce and present their work continuously, because it was not so often happened in this time. Later on, I realized that Berlin was a kind of hidden capital for this so-called Klangkunst in German or sound art, because there was already in the 80s a gallery from a kinetic and sound artist who already showed like 38 exhibitions from international artists, and in a little storage space in Schöneberg, I think, and that was Gianozzo. And there have been also quite important exhibitions, the first one in 1980 in the Academy of the Arts, Für Auge und Ohr, for eyes and for the ear. And later on, like the Sonambient exhibitions, all that stuff happened. And the Berlin Artist Program, which was really important because in the 80s there had been a director of the Visual Arts Department, or maybe the main director, was René Bloch. And maybe somebody of you knows René Bloch because he's really active also in Denmark, and but he was a private gallerist in the beginning for Fluxus artists, and then later on he becoming director of several institutions. And he started to invite sound artists in the program of the music and of the visual arts department, because they have still this kind of strong direction in their selection process. And only Bernhard Leitner, for example, was the only one who been under the cover architect invited. It's also funny. So in this program, a lot of artists came to Berlin, they producing big things, big exhibitions and projects, and staying mainly in Berlin. So a lot of them are still there. Some again moved away or home. But this means there is a kind of creative scene of people in Berlin already. So maybe, as you never know what you do, but in this time, maybe we made the right thing. We started with somebody, and it was not the idea to have it like for 18 years already. It was a starting point for maybe 1-2 years. And we had in the beginning a nice collaboration with the Sonambiente Festival. That means we got two artists completely paid, or with their installations completely paid from the festival, and we gave them our space, our ground floor space, for their activities. So it was a kind of good deal. And later on, we after a second year, we presented 5 exhibitions in the first year already. And later on in the second year, it's like always institutional. When you start independently without any funding, you have no sources somewhere, no private sources or something like this. It's normally, it's have to be finished after a year, because then the partner's going away and whatever. So we overlived this time in a way, and a year later, in 98, we got a funding, a European funding. I don't know why, but it's happened. And the source of the, or the, like the structure is pretty easy and simple, not so complex like the Lead Gallery, because only 2 persons running this place. That's Markus Steffens, a colleague of mine, since 2001, and he also studied with Helga della Motava and me. And then for each production, we hiring special people, technicians or helpers or assistants for the artist. So over the years, when you because when you work in such a kind of independent organization as you see, it's you're never looking backwards, you're looking always forwards, because we have to produce new things. And to do a catalog or a book, it's always interesting to have a kind of overview of what you have done over the times and what the artist doing. And there was the conceptual thing was, I think we wrote in '96 a kind of manifest, which was not called a manifest because we are not artists. It was not an artist production or an artist gallery. It was from the beginning on a curated project initiative on a special space in this moment, where we want to invite national and international and young and well-known artists to work in this space and develop new sound installations for the space. And the space was quite special, and maybe that's also part of the discussion, because in this time, to get a kind of wide cube space, it was not possible to get something like this. And the church was an open structure, like, because there was nobody wants to work there. And we get some income because we rent the space sometimes to others. But and the people thinking I've been the Pope of this church, but that was not true. So it works over 11 years. I don't know how, but it works. Because the mainly thing what we have is the human power and a good artist. I think that is the main reason to that this structure still or was such a long time alive. And we had more and more good interested visitors and the kind of scene which is coming. And the other aim was also not only to focus on the several generations of artists, also to produce only with every artist only one exhibition. That was from the beginning on the kind of aim, because we don't want to be a gallery like selling stuff. That was a project space, and you never know what's happened like in 5-6 years. There are upcoming new interesting artists, and we want to be open. And later on, we in re-inviting artists only when we're doing a public space work, which was also happened from 2000 on. So we produce, I think, in this time, 58 or something like this exhibitions, solo exhibitions purely. And also later on in 2007, we moved to another place because the church want to get more income out of this building, what they have. And we decided to take part in a competition, and we won it to get two big underground water reservoirs, again, a really special structure or architecture in Prenzlauer Berg, in Pankow, in Berlin. And that was a good thing. With this competition was connected a kind of basic funding, because before we never had any basic funding. There was always every project have to be funded over several institutions. It means sometimes 5, 2, 10 embassies, or and what is also special, because from the beginning on, or like after 2 years, I realized I'm completely in another place what I was thinking before. Because as you know already, that I come from music, I studied musicology and social science and also other stuff. But I thought it's a sound gallery is a place for music in the space, because I love music from Nono and Ockeghem, the 16th, 17th century, where musicians placing the music in the space. And that's why also the name was from the beginning Hörgalerie, what does not mean like sound gallery, it's a listening gallery in a real translation. And even after 2 years, I was not really happy with this decision from the beginning of this kind of name or branding. And the title Singuhr, the main title, is followed only this place where we've been, because the Singuhr was a name for the Glockenspiel from the church, which was destroyed in 1944 in the Second World War. The people living around saying to this instrument, because it's playing every 7.5 minutes, a kind of sequence, and you can have a kind of living watch around you, or clock, and the people saying to this instrument Singuhr, and to the church, because the name of the church was Parochial Church, which is really difficult to speak in German because it's Latin. They're saying the Singuhr Church. That was the reason, that was a kind of brand from this place, from the people in the neighborhood. So, and I thought it would be really nice to use this name, Singuhr, as a brand for, or as a name for the gallery, because It was an instrument that was even played in the 20s in the German radio station, like the big band in the BBC, for over 10 years. It's a kind of signal, the bells. It was the biggest Glockenspiel in Germany in this time. So, and as you know, it's a kind of instrument in a public space. And there have been also live concerts with musicians broadcasted in the German radio in the 20s. And so on. So the Zingo name is really following the place where we started, and Listening Gallery was really coming out of my background and of our background in music, because I found the gallery with Susanne Bieners, and she's since, I think, 2002, professor for musicology and history of media in Oldenburg on the university. So she is becoming a researcher, and I stayed working as a curator. And so then after this time, we went to the other place, which is a really difficult place. And I think my time is running, so I can show you some pictures when you want. Yeah? Okay, really, really short. Opa, what's happened here? Well, this is a ground map of the Parochial Church, and from 98 on, we're doing several installations in this big space, which is around 750 square meter without any column, and with an open roof truss, which is really nice sound-wise. And we're starting in a smaller space in the belfry, which was almost echo-free, which is also kind of important part to produce sound installations in the space. So, okay. This is this. So really short rundown. Well, this is the first exhibition in 96. The opening was on the 30th of May, 96, with an East German sound artist who also came more from music. It was a kind of arrangement of sculptures in an installation form. Erwin Stachel is his name. And this was the second installation from a trio, from a composer, a visual artist, and a programmer, Roswitha von Hendrich and Jens-Uwe Differt. Oh, sorry, this. No. So, here. You see already, this was the main space at the beginning. That was a work in 96 too, the third work from Gordon Monaghan as part of the Sol Ambiente Festival. It was an Aeolian harp without any speakers. And as you see here, there have been also little piezo speakers, which are only making not more, one-bit speakers. And that was a big Aeolian harp using the temperature differences from outside and inside, and the wind was going through the building. And it's working after the opening, never anymore, because there have been so much people that the whole space, big walls taking all the temperature. And it was normally a really cold space, and outside it was summer. But with all these people, and after the opening, nothing sounded anymore because the space becoming really warm, and it stayed for the next 6 weeks. That's becoming a kind of an experiment from the artist. It was a piece from Andreas Oldorp in 98. It was the first time when we using the big nave in the church. It was with singing flames and works with hydrogen gas, which you never will do in a normal museum, only with people like me. Because we had 16 bottles, 80-liter bottles of hydrogen under the rooftop. Nobody knows it, even from the church owners, nobody knows it. And it ran over 4 weeks. And when you don't trust artists, don't start with such a project. And this is another work of him with organ pipes, which was not so, security-wise, not so difficult. He creating a kind of... when you know Lamont Young, this kind of space where you listen on this kind of drone, but it's not really a drone. Drone is something else. But you can, when you move, you're getting out a special kind of composition, because it's a kind of ongoing sound. And all the pipes being kind of demolished, and the labium was they changed something. That was a piece from Alvin Lucie, what she presented. I talked about in the short comment. The empty vessels. This is a beautiful feedback piece, and I think one of this kind of I think there are already some key works which you also can install in other places in this sound installation art world. This was a, here you see the big space one time, because he installed for us a special version, because the other one was already existing, as you know, the empty vessels in the collection of the Lyon Art Museum. But I asked him for a new piece, and Arvin said, you know, I made my 7 pieces, that's it. I said, okay, but look in this space, and he has this beautiful piece, music on a long thin wire, which is coming out of from a performance, and became later a kind of installation piece. And then he saw these two windows behind the formerly organ, and he said, oh, let's do 2 wires. And this was the only long thin wire installation with the title Twins with 2 Wires, which was really nice because it was the same material but a completely other reaction, because you put the same sinus tone on 2 wires, but the wire, even the fabric wire, all the time reacted another way. So you see the little magnets or the big magnets. So that was maybe the last piece. It was from Benoit Mowbray, a kind of a speaker, demolished speaker and sculpture in the middle of the church. It's a kind of dome or igloo. You can go in, and they've been only under power. There was no kind of source, sound source. So that was this time, and then we moved. Time is running. Okay, maybe I stop there because I have too much material. And but then we moved to these two big underground water reservoirs with 18 seconds of fall, the one, and the other one 6 seconds of fall. And you can imagine that it's really difficult for an artist to work there. That means from the beginning on, our aim was like inviting an artist that he can see the space and getting something out, and took it with him at home, and then he developed an idea. And we've been in a long time communication. And then he come back and set up the piece in 10 days or 2 weeks, depends. This time you also need, I think, for work. And then also we need the time to find all the financial sources and the partners to produce these pieces. Because in general, I think it's really difficult to say that, but as you get a number in your mind, we need around 20,000 euros to produce a new work. And the aim, the thing is really we want to produce new works and not to like showing art installations. Sometimes I think 5% of the exhibitions being like reinstallations or variations of a piece in this typical space. And last year we stopped after 18 years the activities, because first on the 30th of May we're becoming adult. In Germany with 18 you are adult already. You can start to get a driving license, not like in America with 16, but 18 is a good time to stop. And we also working already 7 years in this other places in Pankow, which consist of little smaller exhibitions in little galleries. So the only thing what I wanted to show you is maybe the ground map of these places to see. So the one have, I think, 1,200 square meters, and the other one 1,900 square meters. It's a really huge space, but you cannot really doing a kind of group exhibition inside, because I think this is one place or one space where one artist have to work with, what we also did. The only thing what we did new in this time, because of the idea also to integrate more the upcoming generation of artists in our activities. So we're organizing, I think, 7 exhibitions or group shows, not group work, a group work from students from different art academies in Europe. That means the thing was that a student cannot work with his own nice individual artwork in this context. So it was always a kind of social group thing what's happened, which was also new for them, and for us it was a really interesting and nice experience to work with it. And then we're closing the whole gallery because first we're losing the spaces and the money for the space, always going down from like 30,000 what we have in the beginning, and with the 30,000 we get out 120,000, 140,000 was the budget every year. So you have to know that we have no really an infrastructure. Every piece needs a special infrastructure. That means special speakers, we have no speakers. We have a lot of fucked up old cables, what we're normally not using because cables are often part of the artwork, so we need to buy new ones. We have some CD players and so, but in general, when you have this public funding, you don't have to, it's forbidden to buy things, you have to rent it. But in general, the money went really down, the funding, and even in Berlin, there's a lot of things happened, and there's, in my understanding, not so much respect for the work, what we did in the last 18 years. And the decision was pretty clear. We cannot go further under this idea. We pay the artist a fee, we pay assistance, we pay technical stuff. We have security, PR, production money, curator money, so everything comes together. And when we don't do this, when we cannot do it anymore, then we stop these activities and going somewhere else or whatever. And then it's like with a little kid, when you start with it, my son has the same age like the gallery, he's 18, and I don't want to kill my son, so I have a lot of thoughts in this time, and then together with Markus, my colleague, we decided to close the gallery with a big party, with all the, we tried to invite all the artists, with like 60 people, it was really nice, in the, on our last exhibition. And then we started with a new project named Singur Projects, which is a really simple bloody name, but it's showing more what we're doing now in the future and in the present time, producing installations still, site-specific installations or situation-specific installations in several spaces, because I think this 18 years been necessary to focus on this production because nobody else did it in this time, also kind of continuously. In 96 also started, for example, in Copenhagen, the Lit Gallery, on this Rathaus Square, and they're publishing this Van Gogh magazine on DVD, and so after 2 years it was completely fucked up because they're getting, because it was a cultural capital year, they're getting a lot of money at the beginning, and we start with nothing. That means we're setting it up step by step, and they're getting, I think, 120 or more thousand. And then after 2 years it was done, and Michael Madsen did a really good job, but I think, Morten, you know it, but from the, in the beginning, but then it's, I think even the metric is not anymore there. Okay, that was a kind of speaker metrics in the ground, also a completely other idea what we had. But and then Michael Schumacher starts in 96 too with his Five Steve Bickham, and later on the Diapason Gallery, which is also closed since 3-4 years already. So 96 was a kind of good year when I'm looking backwards. And now we're producing installations always together with the residency. That was also a kind of experience what we get after 18 years. So we're going to institutions, starting to ask for corporations. Not we having not any space, only a little office, and sometimes the money, the fundings. And we're producing sometimes on the places where we have already the partnership, like in Prenzlauer Berg on the Mainblau project space. We did last year the first project, where an Estonian artist been a month in the space for residency. So he set up everything in the space and have even a week time to work on the sound, which is always a nightmare for a sound artist, I can tell this, because you have always to do the hardware, and that at least comes sometimes the sound works. So there's always no time. So there was a lot of time, and we're doing an open studio and something like this. And then the exhibition was presented for 4 weeks. That means the production and the presentation time was the same for me and for him. So this, we're going further with this. We produce now, our first exhibition is in Mexico this year. I think it's still running till the 31st of May. When you have time, you can go to Morelia. And it was also connected with the residency. And out of this project comes another project, which also a single project is in Oaxaca in November this year, again with the residency. And we are working there on the contemporary art museums, not in this kind of ruined spaces which are always connected with sound art. So it was from the beginning, even after in the last 7 years, we really try to work on this kind of more art typical spaces and not only in the ruins. So we're getting the ruins for free. That was a good thing. All this kind of really interesting locations. I think I'm completely over the time.
Yeah, I think we should round up.
Sorry. Yeah, I have so much question about festivals, but in general, only one thing, but we can also have it in the discussion, maybe. I think I stopped now.
Yeah. Thank you.